But without further ado, I can't tell you how excited I am for this next session. So let me cue her up. And then I'll introduce her really quick before she starts. Let me share my screen. So I'm so excited to introduce Gabrielle Martineau. Like Rebecca said, she is one of the World Oceans Day Youth Advisory Council members, and I'm super thankful to be able to get to work with her nearly on a daily basis or on every other day basis. We chat all of the time, and she's such a leader for our planet. She actually just returned back to Canada. She'll tell you a little bit about where she was at. But during this next session, sit back, relax, as we'll be joining Gabrielle as she takes us on a snorkeling tour in the lagoon located in the tropical waters of de la Réunion, a small island in the Indian Ocean. We will learn more about biology of these species characterizing this island and get insight into how to be an eco-friendly diver slash snorkeler, which is great considering the last session we just were listening to, as there was a lot of talk about diving and just exploring in general. So without further ado, Gabrielle.
Hi, everyone. Can you hear me well?
Yes.
Great. I'm super excited to be here. So good morning or good evening, depending on where you are in the world. So I'm going to explain a bit, tell you a little bit about myself first. So Bailey introduced me, but basically I moved to Île de la Réunion this past semester for a study exchange. So I was there for 6 months and I had the opportunity to study coastal tropical marine ecosystems at the Université de la Réunion through the through a master's program, actually. And I had the idea to, I thought it would be kind of selfish to be there on World Ocean Day and not to make every ocean lovers out there benefit from being on this island. So I had the idea to take you guys on a live snorkeling tour. Sadly, I needed to go back to Canada earlier than expected, and also Youth-A-Thon move dates, but we will make it work. And what I did is that I went in the lagoon and I took videos out there for you guys. So this way I will be able to do a live snorkeling tour as well, but I will also be able, that will allow me to stop and explain you guys some different things about our oceans, and also give you some fun facts, ask you some questions. So please, if ever you guys have some questions, feel free to use the Q&A button. I will try to answer. I want to warn you, I'm not a professional filmmaker, so the videos are kind of like moving all the time. It's not, you will see what I'm talking about. And I'm not a professional taxonomist, so I will do my best if you have questions, but might be wrong on these ones. So yeah, I will start sharing my screen. I have a little presentation for you guys. So let me do that right now. Okay. Can everyone see the presentation? I think so. Let me just check. Okay, so I will go on and start. I'm not seeing the Zoom screen right now, but yeah, okay. Sounds good. So I will tell you a bit about Île de la Réunion. Maybe you don't even know where it is actually. So I made a, little video to show everyone because when I tell people I'm there, they usually need to Google it. So it's a little tiny island. It's a little niche paradise in the Indian Ocean. So it's actually east of Madagascar and southwest of Mauritius, if you heard of those places. So here it is, and there is the lagoon that I'm going to be snorkeling, that we're going to be snorkeling in, actually. So the west side of the island is actually bordered by a lagoon. So it's not the entire island. Going to tell you just a little bit about the island. It is considered to be a really young volcanic island. So it has an active volcano, a volcano. It's called Piton La Fournaise. So basically, the island is a nature paradise. You can see the pictures I took when I was there, except for the last one. It's also a melting pot of European, African, and Asian culture. So it's really a wonderful place to be. And here are some pictures to give you a little bit of a flavor of what it looks like. And I'm gonna just tell you a little bit about the lagoon before I start. So basically, a lagoon is a body of water that's separated from the ocean, either by a sandbar or by, in this case, a coral reef. If you can see the little figure here, La Réunion has, for the most part, fringing reefs that are here. That means that are reefs that are attached to mainland. So they're typical from young volcanic island, and usually they grow into barrier reef after, and potentially into atoll in some cases. So yeah, the west coast of the island is ring by the lagoon. The lagoon is home to more than 3,500 species, marine species, and has been a marine reserve since 2007. So yeah. Also, since the volcanic island is pretty young, that means that the slopes are pretty steep, and that the lagoon is pretty shallow and still pretty small. So it's going to expand throughout the years as the island gets older. So yeah, if you have any questions as well, feel free to ask. Just want to make sure I don't have any questions. I think so far everything is good. Okay, so before we dive in, I'm just gonna give you guys some advice and tips and to bear in mind of how to be an eco-conscious diver or snorkeler. So I made up the three P's because it's easy to remember. So here are some tips for you. So the three P's are peace, plan, and participate. So the first point is peace. So basically what I mean is that when you're a diver or a snorkeler, you want to be at peace with your environment. You want to let the animals be, basically. I like to think that I'm kind of part of the background, mostly when I dive, and that I'm like acting as if I was another fish. So don't try to chase, touch anything. And a really important thing, mostly with coral reefs, is to be careful with your fin and your neutral buoyancy. So since corals are really fragile, just kicking one of them and breaking one can mean can take months of recovery for the reef, actually. So you want to be really careful with that. And you also want to limit flash photography in some cases. So just be aware of the wildlife and try to be at peace with it. And another thing that I think is important that I didn't do in the past is that be an ocean advocate. And if you see someone that's actually acting wrong, just go ahead and tell them and explain them, oh, you shouldn't bother the wildlife. Just go and explain them, because maybe they just don't even know if they're doing something wrong. So just don't be afraid to go and tell other divers or snorkelers how to act. The second P is plan. So you'll see that in this session, I'm actually snorkeling at low tide, which is not ideal. That was my only time to go in the lagoon, but usually you want to be at higher tide in order to not be holding your breath, to not touch the corals. And you want to avoid moments with strong currents and be aware of signs on the beach. If there are signs, be aware, just for your own safety. You also want to be wearing adequate clothing. So if you're working on a reef mainly, they can be cutting. You want to be wearing long wetsuits, even if it's really warm outside. And really important, you want to be wearing coral-friendly sunscreen, which is really important for a reef. And also, if you're diving, try to prioritize eco-friendly diving centers. So you can go on websites such as Green Fins that will give you a list of actually registered diving centers that make ocean conservation their priority. So that can be a good thing to bear in mind. And if you're bringing snacks while diving, please bring a reusable water bottle and avoid single-use plastic. So actually try to bring snacks that are that are not using plastic. And the last P is participate, really important. So if you can, well, you can donate to local conservation organism or also take part in their action. There's tons of ways you can get involved. I'm sure you guys already know if you're here on the World Ocean Day website. Or you can also, just a simple way to take action is to bring a garbage bag with you on the beach and to, just to pick up the rubbish either on the water or on the beach while you're there. So that is it. I'm just gonna check. Oh, okay, sounds good. Because I can't see the comments on my, I share my screen. So, okay, without further ado, I'm gonna take you guys on a snorkeling tour. So basically what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna show you short videos of 2-3 minutes, 1 minute. And then after that, I'm gonna take a time to explain what we've seen or basically give you some fun facts about it. And then we're gonna go back again in the water. So, sit back, relax, and enjoy the swim. Just gonna start some music with it. So. Thank you. Okay, so this was our first snorkeling experience. I hope you enjoyed it. I'm going to go ahead and give you guys some details about it. So, first of all, meet the Rathis family. So this is the first fish family we're going to meet. So this was six bar wrasse, Thalassoma hardwicki, this guy here. I don't know if you noticed. So I took screenshots of actually parts of the video. So maybe you saw the species, or maybe you didn't, but yeah, I'm going to give you details about it. So basically, they're a family that are extremely varied in color, morphology, and size. And they're characterized by swimming with their pectoral fins like this. The name of the family is Labridae, which comes from labrum in Latin. So basically, I like to think that if the Kardashian family was the fish family, it would be the Labridae family, because labrum actually means lips, and they're characterized by having really nice lips. So yeah. As you can see on this picture, they're also carnivores for the most part, and they feed on macro invertebrates, so crabs, shrimps, small gastropods, and they have for most of the species, the ability to change sex from female to male. Just not mistaking this one. So yeah, this is the wrasse family. Actually, this was supposed to be a question, but I think I was supposed to be hiding it. But anyway, does any of you knows what that is? I guess it's written on the screen. Does any of you guys know what it is? If you do, please write it in the chat. So you will see tons of them. I know they're a really appetizing species. So they are, I can't see the chat right now, but I think Bailey is.
We had a couple people. I guessed a rock, which was wrong. Darcy guessed a sea cucumber. For some others to come in.
Okay, great. But yeah, Darcy, was right. So this is a sea cucumber. Really appetizing species. They are echinoderms, just like sea stars and urchins. So the main species we're going to see are Holothuria atra and Holothuria leucospilata. I don't know if I'm pronouncing it right in English. They actually move, believe it or not. And they are able, just like other echinoderms, to reproduce sexually and asexually, and they are super important in our lagoon because basically they feed on organic matter in the sand, and they basically filter this organic matter, so they act as a sand filter, and they limit bacterial proliferation by doing that. So they're really essential to our reefs, and they're also, fun fact, they are a delicacy, as well as they are used for medicine purposes in some Asian countries. So yeah, if ever one of you guys have stepped on a sea cucumber, you'll see that they have a pretty interesting defense mechanism. But if you haven't yet, please just don't step on one. But anyway, yeah, really interesting species. Next one is, I don't know if you actually spotted this one here. This one is part of the grouper family. This is a honeycomb grouper. So the grouper family, or the sea bass, are a pretty diverse family as well. They're characterized by spawning in synchronization with the moon. They're usually carnivores and feed on the bottom and have really powerful jaws for suction effect, to feed on their food, basically. Next is, I'm gonna actually introduce you to some types of corals. So I don't know if you spotted the Johnson damsel fish here. So basically, the lagoon is split in two parts in La Réunion. So there's the back reef depression and the reef flat. So I'm taking you guys on the back reef depression, which is characterized by more massive coral forms. So here is a diagram of different coral forms. And so we're gonna find, we'll see massive and columnar forms, as well as some arborescent corals. But basically the back reef is a bit sadly less healthy, and for many reasons. I was just not able to go swim more far away from the shore on that day. So basically for different reasons that can be linked to pollution, human driven factors, or also climate driven factors. Basically more massive forms are more resistant to those stress usually in general. So here are some species of corals. So here's the massive varieties, and you can see also columnar varieties. The main species here are varieties lutea, varieties cylindrica, and there are also many others you're going to be able to see. Just want to take this opportunity as well to explain you what is a reef. I don't know if everyone knows what are actually corals made out of. So corals are colonial organisms. So they're actually made out of an animal and a plant. So two symbionts that live in harmony together. So the animal is a polyp, is coming from the group of the taxonomic group cnidarians. So this is actually a polyp you can see on the screen with tentacles and a central mouth. And they live in symbiosis with an algae, usually a zooxanthella. So basically the zooxanthella will perform photosynthesis and provide the animal with oxygen and nutrient, as the animal, the polyp, will provide the plant with carbon dioxide and a shelter. So it's a win-win situation, that's how we call it. And basically, corals can be really hard to identify. So most of the time we need genetic tools and molecular tools to do so. So a lot of species can look alike. There are more than 200 species here in La Réunion. So another family of fish are damselfish. So you might have seen that there's a, might have noticed that there's one of the fish that is, I'd say, pretty calm, not aggressive at all. This guy here is Stegastes. It's actually jumping in the screen all the time. So they're really territorial. You're going to see them all the time. There's also other species of damselfish. These one, the Celis arianus, that kind of look like pandas, that are everywhere. They are big egg layers, very territorial and welcoming. And they're usually carnival as well. The clownfish are actually also part of this family. We're not going to see some today. But yeah, just so you know, there's one species that's actually endemic to the Mascaring Archipelago, in which La Réunion figures. So yeah. This is the Silus arianus. And these are some goldfish you might have noticed. So meet the yellow striped goldfish here. They're actually super cool fish. They have a little mustache. They have chin barbels, we call them. They're adorable. So they can be used as sensory organs or also to hunt for food. They usually hunt at the bottom of the seafloor. They can be found in schools and do shadow hunting, and they can change coloration during the day. So these are fun facts about these newly day, we call them. And last for the session are sponges. So sponges, I don't know if you saw them, the massive purple structures here. And yes, they are animals. They're super ancient animals. They're one of the only animals that don't have any digestive, nervous, or respiratory system. So pretty impressive. And they're really, 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 really old. They don't move. They're vary a lot in shapes, color, size, and they feed by filter feeding. So yeah, this is one of this organism species we're gonna encounter along this tour. So without further ado, let's dive in again. Just gonna put the little music. Thank you.
different house and a different name. I could sing your favorite song, yeah, you'd sing along, you'd sing along. I could wrap you in your favorite clothes and kiss your face just so you know that I'm the one who has got your back. Now turn around, don't be sad. I hope you find the love that's true. So
snorkeling tour. Okay, so I don't know if you've noticed, but we actually came across some different types of corals here. So here are some new families, some other families of corals or other groups of corals that vary in morphology, size, and color. So I was talking about branching corals. We saw some, so the Acropora gender here. Here I see them on the pictures, and also here as well. So the main species are Acropora muricata, digitifera, etc. So these ones are more branching types of corals. We also saw fire corals, so Millepora. These ones are called fire corals because they actually burn. Their nematocysts can burn your skin if you touch them, so be aware of them if you snorkel. Just don't touch a coral in general as an advice, but these ones are in particular caught a lot. Also we saw encrusting corals, some Montipora. These ones, they form a crust on top of other corals or other rocks, and they usually they look like a melted candle if I can describe them how they look like. That would be the best way. And I have now a question for you guys. Does anyone know what that is? Or the second pictures, there's also. So, does anyone know what these?
Oh. I was gonna say, we got a guess for algae.
Yeah. Pretty good guess. Okay. Yeah, so basically these are algae covered corals. So they are dead corals. So when a coral dies, it gets covered buried under algae. And here is crystals coralline, usually the pink encrusting algae. So they die because of many reasons. But also they reproduce asexually, so which means that if you break a piece of coral, it's not necessarily dead. It can reproduce to fragmentation, cloning, fission, etc. So I'm gonna talk a bit quickly about coral bleaching, because that's a way coral die. We hear a lot about this this phenomenon in the past year because it's also climate change driven. So I'm just going to explain quickly this phenomenon to you guys. This is coral bleaching happens when the algae symbiont in the coral actually leaves the coral, causing it to bleach, since the algae gives the pigment to the coral. So it's basically only leaving it to be white because of the calcareous structure. So this can be caused by different stress. It can be due to rise of sea surface temperature, rise of acidity, pollution, or just other perturbations. So just to quickly to explain this, these are really basic concepts, but also really good to know. You've also met the Indian Ocean and world famous Moorish idol. So he's better known as Gil and Nemo. I don't know if you guys probably have seen Nemo before. So you'll meet him on the reef a lot today as well. And you also saw our friends squirrel fishes and soldier fish family. They're also hidden most of the time, or sometimes they're in schools. So they're characterized by their reddish coloration and really big eyes, just like squirrels. So these adaptations are made for a nocturnal lifestyle. So they are night owls, and they're equipped with really powerful spine when they get attacked. They feed at night and they usually hide during the day, as you can see here in the picture. So that's it for this one. We're going back in the water again. Quick dive. So we saw other types of cnidarians that you can see there, pretty interesting. Meet the famous parrotfish family. So they are a really charismatic species, better known as the fish that is always laughing or pooping. So you can see on the picture here, their name originates from their beak, just like a parrot, as you can see. They're seen a lot on the reefs, and they're really, really, really important for reefs for many reasons. They're great herbivores. They're scrapers and excavators, which means that they use their teeth to scrape calcareous matter. Usually, they try to target both endolytic and epilytic algae, which means algae that is on top or beneath calcareous matter, and they target different types of food, such as cyanobacteria, microorganisms that feed on seagrasses, algae. So basically, they remove a big part of the calcareous matters on the reef. And this will go through the digestive system and goes back into the reef as sand. So that's why they are also pooping all the time, just because they ingest a lot of calcareous matter. So this will allow the reef to actually regenerate and give opportunity, for example, a young coral reef to settle on it. So that's why they're so important. And fun fact, they have the ability also to change sex. So they're born as a female, and some of them change sex to become male. So male are the colorful version, and I'll show you later what females looks like. And so actually the decision to, or the timing to change sex or not in parrotfish are actually hot topic of research in marine biology, which I find really interesting, and can be driven by age or by sex-related survival rates. So it's pretty interesting. And I don't know if you've noticed, does anyone notice an outstanding behavior at the beginning of the video? A sort of dance with the fish, and I wanted to ask you guys if you know what that was. So with the butterfly fish. So basically, so meet the butterfly fish family. This is a raccoon butterfly fish called Keetodon lunula. This is my favorite one. So he was basically being territorial. These fish are pretty territorial. You meet them a lot. The butterfly fish are really small fish. Most of them, a lot of them are obligate coral feeders or also carnivores, pretty varied in their diet. And they're really good indicators of the health of the reef, basically. There's 24 species of them in Réunion, so you'll meet them a lot. And we'll go back to diving now. Species is in Dory's and Nemo. If anyone knows, any guesses? It's a pretty specific question as well. Okay, so no worries, I will introduce her. So Dory is called a blue tang, actually. She's a surgeon fish. So she's part of the surgeon fish's family, which we just met. Here's a Acanthus triostigus, is one of the surgeon fish that lives in group and that feeds in group. So you'll see them everywhere. They're deep-bodied, colorful fish. They vary a lot in color. They also include unicorn fishes, if you've seen some before. They're herbivores, and they're called surgeon fish because near their tail, they have a spine located near their tail that's really looking like a surgeon's scalpel. So you'll see it only if they're feeling threatened. This is why they're called surgeon fishes. And we'll see some more, and I'll point them out to you later. We also saw the pufferfish family. So this is a black-spotted puffer, super cute, I think. So they have the characteristic to be able to expand their body by filling their stomach with water. And they also have, they also produce neurotoxin, that makes them poisonous if you eat them. They're also super adorable, and they are scaleless. So, they also vary a lot. They have sexual and age dimorphism, which means that the same species can look different at different ages and different sex. So the male and the female look different, which happens a lot in fish. And this is an example of a female parrotfish. As you can see, the color different is pretty noticeable here. So yeah. Let's dive in again.
Homegrown alligator, see you later. Gotta hit the road, gotta hit the road. The sun ain't changing the atmosphere. Architecture unfamiliar, I could get used to this. Time flies by in the yellow and green. Stick around and you'll see what I mean. There's a mountain top that I'm dreaming of. If you need me, you know where I'll be. I'll be riding shotgun underneath the hot sun, feeling like a someone. I'll be riding shotgun underneath the hot sun, feeling like a someone. South of the equator, navigator, gotta hit the road, gotta hit the road. Deep sea diving round the clock, bikini bottoms, lager tops, I could get used to this. Time flies by in the yellow and green. Stick around and you'll see what I mean.
Okay. So yeah, we've met another member of the pufferfish family. So this is Cantagaster, I'm not sure which one this one is, but it's the black saddle toby. So he's pretty cute. He's also the same, so he's also a member of the pufferfish family, as I said. And here are some more sponges, if you were wondering what that was. Yeah, these ones are really smelly. If you pick them up, you can actually, they actually smell pretty strong. Yeah. So just let me check quickly how much time we have. So I think we're gonna skip this video since you know, have only 10 minutes left. But yeah, I just want to show you guys some pictures that we see on this one. Nothing new, but we saw you saw an example of, you would have seen an example of bleach coral here. So that's what it actually looks like. And there were some examples of damselfish we saw before, a chromis species here, pretty colorful, pretty. And here are some other butterfly fishes. And this is another type of surgeonfish, you know, Teus striatus, that we see a lot. So now a little bit of some extra footage for you guys. So some footage I was taking a bit after before, but I thought it was pretty relevant to show you guys some other features in this lagoon. So these are some pictures I took some other days. The videos weren't too good, so I didn't show them. But just to show you guys some other types of corals that we can find in La Réunion. So here are some cauliflower corals, so Pusillopora, ginger. You can see what it looks like. This one doesn't look too healthy, maybe a bit bleached. These are some mosaic corals here and some mushroom corals. So as you can see, corals can take really, really many, many, many shapes, colors, morphologies. And yeah, so this is another little video, one of my favorites. So you'll see another type of fish in this one. Let me just.
There's a mountain top that I'm dreaming of. If you need me, you know where I'll be. I'll be riding shotgun underneath the hot sun, feeling like a someone. I'll be riding shotgun underneath the hot sun, feeling like a someone. We got two in the front, two in the back.
So we actually only saw it at the beginning of the video, but it's a trumpet fish. They're pretty impressive. They're about 80 centimeters long, and Yeah, they're really cute looking. They also hide sometimes in the water column, so you'll turn around and see them, but they're not dangerous. They're just really cute. So next is a video of that I took at sunset another day. So you can see the contrast of different types of fish at different different times of the day. So yeah, this will be our last snorkeling video before we close up the session. But yeah, let me play.
Time flies by in the yellow and green. Stick around and you'll see what I mean. There's a mountain top that I'm dreaming of. If you need me, you know where I'll be. I'll be riding shotgun underneath the hot sun, feeling like a someone. I'll be riding shotgun underneath the hot sun, feeling like a someone. I'll be riding shotgun underneath the hot sun, feeling like a someone. I'll be riding shotgun underneath the hot sun, feeling like a someone, 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 someone.
So I have a couple of minutes left, but I hope you enjoyed this snorkeling session. Before we leave, I wanted to ask you guys a really, really important question. So a little bit of introspection here. So my question to you, if you can answer in the chat, is if you were a fish, if you were to be a fish, which one would you be and why? We saw a lot of different species of fish in a coral. So here I put again some images of some of the fish we encounter. But yeah, if you can answer in the chat, I'd be curious to see which one would you be and why. Don't be shy.
Also, while people are answering, Gabrielle, we got a question in the chat asking, yes, how often do you, or did you go snorkeling when you were in you have like the perfect way of saying it.
Yeah, I guess it's a bit tricky to say in English, but having classes before the confinement, I would go at least 2 times a week because it's dark there pretty early, maybe 6 o'clock. I wouldn't have time to go on weekdays unless I have classes canceled. But on the weekends, I try to go at least once to see. And we did some really cool hands-on work in the lagoon in one of our coral reef classes, which is really interesting. So we got to spend 3 days there working with species. And this happened right before the confinement. So we were really lucky.
That's awesome. So I can keep reading the chat for you. So we have Lydia said that she would be a damselfish. I love their attitude and they're really cute. Darcy said, I love parrotfish. They are so important to coral reef ecosystems and are just so cool. And I said parrotfish, easy, because it's colorful and unique. So while people are putting their answers in the chat, and I'll be monitoring YouTube for that, we got another question for you. So I know that you've been, you've dived quite a bit in your life, but just was wondering what has been your favorite encounter to date while snorkeling or just in the ocean or in the water in general?
Wow, that's pretty hard, a tough question. But also, thank you guys for answering the fish questions. These are all really good answers. So basically, the coolest dive I've had I think probably was in the Arctic, so northern ecosystems. And we actually saw some, I think, I don't know if you, maybe you guys can Google it. It's called a sea angel, we usually call it. It's a pelagic gastropod. It really looks like, it's really tiny, it lives in the water column, and it looks like a little angel swimming. So that's like just a little, very, very unique species that I got to see while diving, which was really exciting because it's really specific to cold water ecosystems. And yeah, I was not expecting to see it, and I turn around and maybe I can share a video later of it on Instagram or something. But yeah, that was probably the most magical moment.
That's awesome. Oh yeah, Lydia said she loves sea angels. They're so, so cool. We got another question for you. What first inspired, you know, your love for kind of diving and exploring and you know, knowing so much as you do about these special species?
My love for marine biology started off basically when I was lucky enough to do take part in the classical program, it's called. So basically, I sailed across the Atlantic while doing my grade 12 of studies. And there I was living on the ocean. So I was, living there every day and also diving a lot, snorkeling a lot. And I got also an awesome marine biology teacher there and friends that were really into marine expeditions. So this kicked off my passion, my love for marine biology. And now I'm studying general biology, but I'm trying to do as many internships as I can in marine biology and try to go to as many places as I can. And I think that both tropical and cold water ecosystems are just amazing.
Yeah.
For different reasons.
No, that's great. Another question is, what is on your bucket list to explore next?
Oh, that's a good one. I would love to go to Antarctica. I have some coworkers that have been there, and it's just like really, really unique places that almost no one goes to. I really also want to dive in. I've never been also to the Coral Triangle, which is located between Papua New Guinea, Australia, as well as Papua New Guinea, Australia, and Southeast Asia. So basically in that area. I've never dived there yet, and this is where marine biodiversity is at its peak. So that would be really interesting. But also a dream would be to exploring the deep sea, places like the Marianas Trench, which is the deepest place in this seaport.
That's super special. I'm sure, as you know, you're saying that, a lot of us are thinking, oh man, I'd love to do that, or that's on my bucket list too. So for any of you watching this afterwards, you know, jot down where some of those places are, because I guarantee, you know, the more that you kind of manifest those and put those out there, you know, the more likely that, you know, you might be able to go to one of those places one day. So before we close off, Gabrielle, is there, you know, any last piece of advice for anyone watching who's, you know, wanting to do something similar or just get involved in protecting these special places?
I'd say, first of all, thank you all of you guys for being there. I was super excited to be part of Youth-A-Thon, and I'm super thankful to be a World Ocean Day Youth Advisory Council member. But to anyone that's interested in getting involved in marine sciences or conservation, I would just say start now and try doing something. Even if you start by something small, it's like just starting by something. You can be volunteering, getting involved with some conservation organizations, NGOs, or if you're really, really into it, you can start. You can basically study marine biology, but you always start at the bottom. And then, like, if you're really interested and passionate about it, you'll see that there's plenty of opportunities out there. And don't be afraid to ask people. most of the time marine scientists always need a little help. So they will really appreciate you being interested in their work or wanting to help them. So just don't be afraid to go out there. And So.
That was so special. Thank you so much, Gabrielle. I felt like we were with you there. I felt like I had my like underwater headphones in and we were diving, looking at all the cool species and creatures and just the wonderful life. And, you know, across Youth-A-Thon, kind of the general theme obviously is protecting our planet, and especially, you know, signing that Campaign for Nature 30 by 30 petition to encourage our world leaders to protect at least 30% of our planet by 2030. And so for me, this is a great session to remind myself why, like why do we need to do that? And it's because I don't want to have to tell my kids, well, there was once a thing called a parrotfish, but it's no longer here, but it's really cool. I want them to be able to see it. You know, I want them to be able to experience that, similar to you, Gabrielle. So thank you so much for being here. Honestly, congrats. So I didn't say this at the beginning, but Gabrielle actually, she applied to host one of these sessions via the Youth Rise Up contest. So congrats again, Gabrielle. Thank you so much for your work in protecting our planet, sharing your passion and educating others on, you know, why this is so critical and is so, so important to do both now, but, you know, for future generations to come. So thank you so much.
Thanks to you, Bailey. And thanks for everyone that was here. I hope you guys enjoy the rest of Youth-A-Thon. So yeah, thank you everyone.
Bye, Gabrielle.